God bless you for choosing to listen to this anointed message from Dr. Reverend Christopher Abhulime of King's Tabernacle, where Jesus Christ is Lord and we are bringing the kingdom to the nations.
And the title for today's conversation, I say, is Beyond Excitement. Simple. Beyond Excitement. And I have read and stumbled again on this verse of scripture as the Lord Jesus began to counsel and admonish his disciples. And it came out and struck me in a different way as I examine these passages of Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10 from verse 17. And we will tie that to Paul's writing in 1 Corinthians chapter 9 from verse 24. And so Jesus, as he did before this, sent his 12 disciples to go out and minister. And here the Bible say, again he sent the 70. Verse 17. And after he sent them, they returned to him. After he sent them out, they returned to him. And upon their return, this verse opens saying, and the 70 returned again with excitement. The 70 returned again with excitement. And I believe God for you, that as you return to your home today, you return with excitement, with great joy unspeakable in the name of Jesus Christ. And so the scripture says, and the 70 disciples of Jesus Christ, because sometimes we lay so much emphasis on the 12, but there were more than the 12. The 12 were the inner caucus, you would say, of the disciples, and they later on were called the apostles. They were with Jesus more than the rest of them. The rest of them returned home, but the 12 stayed. And there were more than 70. In the multitude, the Bible calls them, because they were innumerable. And so, but the disciples of Jesus that we know, the 12, always stayed with him. And the more they stayed with him, the more he rubbed off on them. That's what made them different. The more, if the 70 or the multitude had spent the same amount of time that the 12 spent with Jesus, they would have been just like the 12 disciples. So the more time they spent with Christ, the more Christ rubbed off on them. And the more they carried on the nature of Jesus. And you just think about it. The more time you spend with somebody, somehow you start to talk like him. Glory to God. You start to behave like him. You know, the Bible says that evil communication corrupts good morals. In other words, when you stay too long with a bad person, you start getting bad to yourself. And when you stay long with a good person, you start getting good. It rubs off on us. The more you stay with the anointing, the more the anointing falls on you. And you remember Lot. Lot had come with Abraham. Abraham took him. And the more Lot stayed with Abraham, the more Lot got blessed. It wasn't so much as the blessing of Lot, it was the blessing of Abraham. But Lot was a partaker, an extension of that blessing, because Lot had spent so much time with Abraham. So when you spend time with a foolish man, you start becoming foolish yourself. Glory to God. And so Jesus' disciples, the 70, had been with him, but the 12 had spent so much time with him. And the 12 went on to be like Jesus. And when they came to town back in the day in Antioch, and the people who saw them by their behavior said, these guys look like Christ. Some of us didn't know him, but we heard about him. And this folk that came to town newly, they reflect that image that we heard. And that's what God expects of you and me. That whatever we are in our neighborhood, in our home, we reflect the very image of Jesus Christ and the image of God. And so the 70 receive a mandate from Christ to go out and stand on his behalf and speak on his behalf. In other words, they were Christ's ambassador to the world. And after they had done all that Christ had commanded them to do, they returned. And they returned with excitement or with joy. And they said to the Lord, Lord, as we went, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. And don't forget, through thy name, not just subject unto us, but subject unto us through thy name. So it is clear from that sentence that the devils are subject to the name of Jesus. It is clear that devils are subject to the name of Jesus. In other words, whenever the name of Jesus is mentioned, the devils will bow. They will be subject to Jesus. You know what subject is? Subject is subject worship the majesty. Worship the majesty. Glory to God. So when Jesus is mentioned, every devil in hell worship. Glory. They bow to that name. Not to the disciples. It didn't say that the devils were subject unto us. And we got to be careful. It has nothing to do with me. It's all to do with God and Jesus. So they're not subject to me. They're subject to me in the name of Jesus Christ. So when I bring the name of Jesus Christ, the devil becomes my subject. And therefore, I rule over him. I have dominion over him. I have authority over him. And we talked about authority the other day and power. I have authority over him. Therefore, I can stop him and he will stop. I can command him and he will obey. Because I have authority over him. How? In the name of Jesus. So they established that fact. That even, and that word even brings a different meaning to it. That there were more things that were subject to the disciples in the name of Jesus. But the highlight was the devil subject to them. So of all that happened as they went, every miracle that they did, the most exciting to them was that the devil was subject unto them in the name of Jesus. And that's great. Every Christian should be excited if you're in this situation. You ought to be excited. You have every right to be excited. If you were to go out of this place and you physically see the devil and you speak in command in the name of Jesus and the devil bowed to you, you ought to be excited. You feel good. You feel on top because everybody is scared of the devil. Everybody's scared of him. And I sometimes laugh that we may get to heaven someday and the Lord presents the devil. And we just look at him. Are you the devil that I've been afraid of? You find this caricature of nothing so little. And he terrorized the entire world. And you feel so bad that you've been afraid and scared of this little thing. I think about that sometimes. But I'm confident in the fact that regardless of how he look, regardless whether he is big or small, tall or short, scary or not, he's subject to the name of Jesus. For me, that is important. He is subject to the name of Jesus Christ. And so we have every right to be excited when we come home and we know that the devil has been subject to us. And so the disciples came with that great excitement to Jesus. But there was something beyond the excitement. As Jesus listened to them, I could feel just Jesus sitting down. Like he did when they brought the woman who had committed adultery, and Jesus said he was writing on the ground as all of the men talking and wanting to condemn this woman and stone her. And the disciples, as they were speaking in excitement, everybody jumping, testifying, giving God glory. Wow. Peter, tell us about the devil that you cast out over there in Capernaum. Oh, John, tell us the other one that you cast out in Nazareth. You saw that manifestation that you didn't even lay hand on that person. And there was so much evacuation, demonic powers from them. You know that. And they were testifying and feeling so excited. And Jesus listening to them, 70, one after the other. And then characteristics of him, Jesus interjected. Something that is beyond the excitement of the fact that the devils were subject to them. And in verse 18, look at what he said to them. And he said unto them, while you were out there, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. And that establishes the fact that wherever you are, Jesus is with you. If he sent you, he will be with you. He was not physically with the disciples while they were doing their thing, 70 of them. But he was monitoring everything that was happening. He saw everything. He put them all online. Everything to try to come against those boys and girls that he sent out, 70 of them, he put them online. It wasn't them. There was a force that was before and after them. There's a glory that surrounds you and me that we may not even realize. That you can walk through the valley of the shadow of death and you come out on the other side, you wonder, how did I break through? What happened here? How did I come through this and I survive it? Has nothing to do with you, man. It's the grace of God. Glory to God. And so he said to them, I'm glad for you that devils were subject to you in the name of Jesus. However, when you went, I was right here monitoring the battlefield. I was the one doing the fight. You just got the glory. Hallelujah. I was doing the work. You got that glory. He said, I beheld Satan himself. You're all talking about the devil. You cast out the devil. Devil subject to your name. But I defeated the devil when he was coming against you. I saw him coming against you all to embarrass you. I saw him coming to stop the work of the ministry. But I also beheld him fall from heaven like lightning. He said, I did that. I made sure that you are all right. I make sure you're all right. And I just like the question that he asked his disciples after he asked them to go out on this trip. And they came to him. And he had told them, he said, as you go, he said, don't take anything with you. Leave your wallet at home. All you ladies, leave your purses at home. Leave everything. Leave your money. Just go. He said, when you go into that town, folks are going to receive you. Paraphrasing now. He said, when they don't receive you, just check the dust of your shoes and move on. And they went. Listen to this. They all went with nothing. Nothing. No food, no money, nothing. And they went. Jesus is testing and stretching their faith. He's teaching them to rely on him as their El Shaddai, the multi-breasted one, their provider. He's teaching them. And they went. And they came back. Like, that's the way, rejoicing. And Jesus called them and said, come. Come here, all of you. He said, when you went and took nothing with you, did you lack anything? That was the ultimate question. That was that. I would feel when he asked that question, the disciples have reminded themselves, yes, we did not. Even though we took nothing with us, we brought so much with us. Just the power of God's providence. That where there is a vision, there's a provision. God will take care of me. He'll take care of you. My labor in the Lord is not in vain. He'll take care of us. As long as we trust in him and our faith is in him, he will take care of us. That's the message that the Lord Jesus was saying to the disciples. He said to them, leave everything home, go and see the glory of the Lord. And when they came back, they were not disappointed. Jesus asked them, when you went, did you lack anything? Were you hungry? They said, no. Did you lack clothing? They said, no. Did you have a place to stay? They said, yes. Did folks show you mercy and favor? He said, yes. It's not by your power. I needed to teach you that lesson so you can depend on me from now on. Glory to God. What is it that you lack today? What is it that you lack today that God cannot do? Tell me. What is it that you are praying for that you know as Christians that God can do this? How many of us sitting here can answer that question? Say, yeah, I have this so big and God cannot answer it. No, we can't. Because God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ever ask or think. God does more than I ask. He does more than I think in my mind and my spirit. So he is bigger than everything that I ask. I can't confine God to one answer to prayer. No. That he put money in my pocket doesn't mean that that's all that he can do. That he gave me health in my body doesn't mean that that's all he can do. He can do so much more than that. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So don't fret. Don't be afraid of tomorrow. Tomorrow's going to take care of himself. He said, look at the sparrows. No one of them fall to the ground without my knowledge. He said, I'll take care of them. He said, look at them. How many of them put stuff in barns and keep stuff away? He said, but I'll take care of them. He said, then look at the lilies of the valley. He said, they build more array than Solomon was in all of his glory. So he'll take care of you, he'll take care of me. We want more than the sparrow. We want more than the lily of the valley. That's what he said. Therefore, we learn to rely on him and rest on him every single day for every single thing. And so as they got excited, and Jesus said to them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall out of heaven, from heaven. And then he said in verse 19, he said, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. He said, and nothing, he said, shall by any means hurt you. Now, this gentleman and woman came to Jesus and told him all that had happened in the mission field. And Jesus said to them, I was with you. You didn't know it. He said, even then, he said, I give you power. I empower you. I empower you to tread on serpents and scorpions. And what he's saying to them, he said, you don't know where you sit in the program of God. He said, you have no idea of the revelatory power that's at work in you. He said, you have no idea. You're talking about, you're getting excited about the devil. They are subject to you in the name of Jesus. He said, there's more to it that you don't understand. There's more to this work that we don't understand. There's more to his plan that we don't understand. There's more to his purpose that we do not understand. He said, I give you power to tread on serpent and scorpions. And not only that, but all over the power of the enemy. That's what he said. He said, you're over all the power of the enemy. All the power of the enemy. He said, those little things that you saw, said it's greater. There's something greater and bigger than that that you have that you don't realize. Say, I give it to you. Over all the power of the enemy. And he said, nothing. See, as long as I live, the Ancient of Days, the beginning, the end, the first, and the last, the Alpha and the Omega, A and Z, creator all of the entire universe. He said, as long as I live, he said, nothing. What is nothing? Nothing means nothing. He said, nothing. He said, I put my name, I stake everything on this. I tell you the truth that as long as I, Jesus, is Jesus, he said, nothing shall by any means hurt you. In other words, you have absolute immunity against the powers that are present today and those that will thereafter come. He said, nothing shall by any means hurt you. That's what the Lord said to them. And the Lord put these details in it to let them know that it's something beyond excitement. That you ain't seen anything yet. You have not seen anything yet. You're excited about the miracle of headache that was healed. There's something greater than that. You're excited about how God showed you some favor. There's something greater than that. You're excited about how God loved you. There's something deeper than that. You're excited of how God moved the mountain. There's something higher than that. God is bigger than anything. So Jesus wanted them to understand that. And then the Lord's conversation continues. And he said in verse 20, and this is classical of how Jesus will present his message. He puts us in a journey, and sometimes in suspense. The disciple came and Jesus told them a parable. And after Jesus had long-winded said the parable, and they said to him, we don't understand what you're talking about. Can you break it down for us? Glory to God. Hallelujah. So Jesus brought them to a climax. From the devils are subject to you, to I saw Satan, I beheld him fall like lightning, to I have given you power over all the powers of the enemy to tread on snakes and scorpions, and nothing shall by enemies hurt you. I put you so high above all these things that you are talking about. 2 verse 20. And now the Lord said, notwithstanding. In other words, this is the most important part. He said, notwithstanding, rejoice. In this rejoice not, he said. Notwithstanding, in this rejoice not, that spirits are subject unto you. Now just look at what the Lord, how the Lord presented this message to his disciples. Now they're excited inside, listening to all of this exciting thing. Great manifestation power and all of this happening. The drama, dramatic event. Cast out devils, raise the dead, heal the sick. And then Jesus said, notwithstanding. So guys, listen to me. I know all of these things are good. I know it's good. There's excitement when somebody lay a hand on somebody and then there's healing. And the church goes, wow. There's excitement when there's a miracle of what God has done. Yes, the church goes, wow. Yes, we ought to. We ought to celebrate those things. It is good to celebrate those things. Jesus didn't say, don't rejoice. No. He said, it's okay to do that. But there is something else that should excite you beyond the manifestation. Said, notwithstanding. Notwithstanding. In this, rejoice not. In this, rejoice not. The spirits are subject unto you, but rather, that's where he was going all along, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Is that what Jesus said? What should matter most to you is that your name is written in heaven. He said, if anything should excite you, not just that casting out the devils and all of that, which is good, the part of what we should do, and we ought to rejoice when miracles happen and great things happen. Perish head, glory. Rejoice in this one thing, that your name is written in heaven. He said, the greatest of my testimony, the greatest of my testimony is not the miracles that happen. It's not the casting out of the devils. It's not that so many souls that I want. Those are good. But the greatest of my testimony is that I'm a child of the living God, born by the Spirit of God, and my name is written in heaven. Because the rest of all of these things could be either duplicated or done by others. He said, remember how he started. He said, devils were subject to us in thy name. In other words, someone who is not part of his discipleship could pick up that name, and Satan was still subject to that name. So the Lord is saying that the action is not in you, with you, but in the name of Jesus. So just because I say the name and spirits are subject to that name doesn't mean that I'm saved. That's what he said. He said, men who come to me and said, I did so much miracle in your name. Yeah. And I knew with them, but it's the name. Regardless, devils are subject. If birds would call the name of Jesus, Satan would still bow. If dogs would call the name of Jesus, Satan would still bow. If horses would call the name of Jesus, demons would still be subject to that name. If fishes in the ocean would call the name of Jesus, demons would still be subject to that name. Because that name had been highly exalted. It's empowered by God. So Christ is saying, it's not so much in you, but in the name. Therefore, you should not be rejoicing alone just because you went out and those demons were subject to you. You 70, there are some of you who are devils. I'm sure Judas Iscariot was one of them, 70 who went. But you know that he had a devil in him. Yet, when he mentioned the name, the devil in him and the devil outside of him were subject to the name of Jesus. At least at that moment that he mentioned them. And so Christ said, beyond the excitement, there's something more to be excited about. Be excited about your birthright. That you are a child of the living God. And that's why Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God unto salvation. Not ashamed of that. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And every believer, every child of God should be excited about your birthright. And you should never be ashamed of who you are. Your identity in Christ is not a liability. Glory to God. Your identity in Christ is not a liability. Glory to God. God had made you a child of his. And because you're a child of him and you have the name of Jesus, therefore everything in the world is subject to you by default as long as you mention the name of Jesus. And so this is what matters. Jesus is saying to them, this is what matters. Glory to God. Notwithstanding, in this rejoice not, that spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. And that Paul's writing as we close 1 Corinthians chapter 9 from verse 24. 1 Corinthians 9, 24. And Jesus said, Paul writing here, he said, know ye not that they which run in a race all run. Ever been to the Boston Marathon? You have many people get on it. I can go there and decide I want to run. Glory to God. So many run. He said, but one receiveth the prize. 1 Corinthians 9, 24 and following. Many get in the race, but one receiveth the prize. So run, he said, that ye may obtain. Verse 25. And every man and woman too that striveth for mastery, if you're looking to be good in what you do, he said, you're temperate in all things. Have self-control in all things. You're disciplined. You know, discipline is the same root word from the word disciple. Disciple and discipline is from the same root word. So when you're a disciple, we talk about disciples of Jesus, 70 disciples, 12 disciples, and all disciples is the same root word as discipline. So a disciple must be disciplined. It must be a disciplined man, a disciplined woman. With absolute high level of self-control. That's what disciple is. It's a disciplined individual. And so the Lord said, if I am, Paul writing here, if I am striving to be a vessel unto honor for God, then I ought to have self-control. Self-control in everything. It's a mastery. It's temperate In what? In all things. In all things, it said. Let's go on. Now, they do it. They do it to obtain a corruptible crown. But we are in this for an incorruptible crown. He said, 20 says, I therefore so run, not as one who has no direction, so fight I, not as he that beateth the air, lost in the maze. 27. But I keep my body and bring it unto subjection. I got self-control. Hallelujah. I bring it under subjection. He said, why I bring it under subjection? Why do I do this? This is Paul right now. You know, Paul was very studious. He was an astute student of the Word of God. Very knowledgeable in theology. He studied under the best, Gamaliel, the best professor. And he had so much knowledge about the Old Testament. And that's what helped him as he related it to the New Testament. And through his ministry, there were a lot of miracles and things that happened. The Lord used them. Set up churches all over the place. Wherever he went, Paul would convince you to receive Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior. So he had this great resume. And he said something. He said, I count all these things but dung for the excellency of the love of Jesus. Said, not this. All of this thing that I have accomplished. You know, sometimes we relish in our own accomplishment. We relish in our own accomplishment. But I always remember that God said, for without me, you can do nothing. Glory to God. That's what he said. For without me, you can do nothing. Rather than relish in our own accomplishment, let's give God the glory. I need somebody who would say, it is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in my life. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So that was such a person as Paul. And Paul says here, he said, I keep my body under subjection. And he said, lest by any means that nothing in this world, whether it be depth or height, angels or devils, principality or power, nothing shall separate me from the love of Jesus. That's Paul's testimony. He said, lest when I have preached to others, when I have won the souls and raised the dead and cast out the devils and healed them all, which is part of my mandate as an apostle unto Jesus Christ, said, I myself should be a castaway. Again, Jesus said to them, I like all of these things that have just happened. I was part of it. That the devils were subject to you in my name. I was part of it. But he said, just like Paul said, after I have preached to others, I myself should be cast away. He said, don't be overexcited about all of this. Let us major on the major. He said, it's like Jesus saying to them, the most important part is what you're neglecting. You're neglecting the most important part. You're allowing the excitement to becloud that which is important. He said, you're allowing all these things to occupy your mind that you're losing sight of what God wants to do. It would have been nice as they came and that happened and they're ready for the next assignment. But it sounds like they just wanted to build a tent. One for Moses, one for Jesus, and one for Elijah. And let us just camp here and stop all of this. But Jesus said, there's more to do. There's a mountain to climb. There's valley to go through. There's river to cross. We're just starting. There's more coming. But rejoice that your name is written in heaven. That as long as your name, you maintain your record in heaven, demons will continue to be subject to you. That's what it's saying to them. As long as you maintain the secret of your success, he was saying to them, is the fact that you're anchored. You're anchored to God. Your name, it's written in heaven. Glory to God. Lift up your hand and just bless the Lord. Lift up your hand, bless the Lord this morning. Just bless him. If your name is written in heaven this morning, give glory to God for your salvation. Get excited, for God saved you just in time. When you were on your way to hell, God brought you out. And God saved you by his power and has given you grace and glory. Hallelujah. Come and help me give him glory and just bless the Lord in this house right now for your salvation, for the saving power of Jesus, the death of Christ on the cross, the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Oh yes, we give you praise and glory, God. Thank you for our salvation. Yes, God, we rejoice that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Oh God, I bless your name. I worship your majesty. Good God on high, you are so good to me. And I thank you for your goodness and your kindness and your compassion. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. 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 Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. Glory to God. If you're not sure that your name is written in heaven, you pray today and just call on God and say, God, I want my name to be in heaven. I want my name to be on there. Lord, don't delete my name. Don't delete my name from it. Lord, I want my name to be on there. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you. I give you glory. Lord, I pray today that I'll maintain my record. I will maintain my record with God. In the name of Jesus. I'll maintain my record with God. In the name of Jesus Christ. Yes, Lord. Don't let me do anything that will remove my name from heaven. In the name of Jesus. Don't let me go anywhere that Jesus comes and said, for I know you not. Yeah, no, Lord. No, Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, I will not have preached to others and I myself should be a castaway. No, Lord. No, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Keep me, sustain me, hold me up. Oh, Lord Jesus, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Blessed be the name of the Lord. 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 Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you have been blessed by this message or have a prayer request, we would like to hear about it. Please call us at 401-954-6188. Or visit our website at www.kingstabernacle.org. You are also welcome to join us on Sundays for services beginning at 8:30, 10 a.m. or 6 p.m. and for Wednesday Bible studies at 7 p.m. We are located at 500 Greenville Avenue in Johnston, Rhode Island. Please remember that you are always welcome at King's Tabernacle, where Jesus Christ is Lord, and we are bringing the kingdom to the nations.